Hi, everyone. This is Marcia Anderson now. So thanks to Carol for that. So I am Cree Anishinaabe. I work in Winnipeg and urban Indigenous health. One of the big things that I'm working on right now is the impact of crystal meth on our youth in the North End, predominantly Indigenous youth, and culture-based harm reduction solutions. So what I'm going to go through today is a little bit of how we got to the program that we're operating now with funding from Public Health Agency of Canada called the 13 Moons Project. And so I just wanted to start with this call to action from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, call to action number 18. It says that we call upon the federal, provincial, territorial, and Aboriginal governments to acknowledge that the current state of Aboriginal health in Canada is a direct result of previous Canadian government policies. And one thing I would say about that first and foremost is that we have to recognize any substance use, including the use of crystal meth, predominantly as a health issue. And in that way, it also is the result of previous Canadian government policies. And Carol had talked about intergenerational trauma as one result of that colonial policy framework. Now, I want to share two different frameworks or models to again build on that and contextualize how I approach and understand substance use. And this first one is called the Gardener's Tale, and it's a framework for understanding multi-level racism. One of the things that's been on my mind a lot since yesterday is that a new First Nations health atlas was released in Manitoba. And not surprisingly, but very starkly, what it shows is actually widening gaps in health status. And so life expectancy, the gap has widened. And in 2002, the life expectancy gap between First Nations and other people in Manitoba was 7 years. And this report showed that life expectancy gap to be 11 years on average. And there are a lot of other gaps that it shows widening. And I think when we look at gaps like that, we have to understand how they're a function of racism and colonialism. And that includes gaps in the harms experienced from substance use. So I just wanted to say that, and then I'm going to describe this allegory briefly. So it's a way for us to understand institutional racism, so the differential access to the goods, services, and opportunities of society by race, and interpersonal racism. So really quickly, there's a gardener, and he has packets of seeds for two flowers. One pack of seeds for red flowers and one pack of seeds for pink flowers. He prefers the red flowers. He thinks they are inherently stronger, more beautiful, and last longer. So he goes out and he buys a new flower pot and some fresh new soil, and he plants the seeds for the red flowers into that new flower pot. At the same time, he just goes to his garage and finds an old flower pot and puts some dry soil in it because he doesn't want to invest too much in the seeds for pink flowers that he doesn't even really like anyways. He waters the seeds for the red flowers regularly, and if there's a few drops of water left in the watering can, he'll sprinkle them on the seeds for the pink flowers. He has one of those shaker things of plant food, and he regularly shakes that plant food onto the flower pot where those red flowers are growing. But he actually holds back from giving any of the food to the seeds for the pink flowers because he doesn't want to run out of food for the red flowers. Over time, he ensures that the red flowers get the right amount of sunlight and rotation. Maybe he even sings to them because he hears that music helps flowers grow better. But the pink flowers, he pretty much just leaves off in the corner. What happens is that all of the red flowers grow to at least an average height, and most of them grow strong and lush and beautiful. At the same time, most of the seeds for the pink flowers die out, and only the very strongest of them reaches an average height. And then he looks at the flowers and he says, "See, I was right to prefer red flowers all along." And the story of the allegory really is a story of how we create health outcomes and differences in health outcomes by the conditions and the environment that people are growing up in. And the question that it asks in the bottom right there is, who is the gardener? And often we think about that as the state government, the federal, provincial government, and all the impacts that they have on our lives. But I think in our country, we also need to remember the role of us as citizens who participate in democracy, or us as healthcare providers who can act as gatekeepers to accessing systems or advocating for differences in systems. And so there is a level of individual responsibility too in the collective creation of the societies that our kids and our youth are growing up in. And then this next slide shows a model developed by Karina Walters and colleagues. And it's called the Indigenous Stress Coping Model. And what this is showing is that health outcomes for a population can be somewhat understood or even predicted if we consider the range of stress that they're exposed to and the balance of buffers or coping mechanisms that they have available to handle that stress. And kind of simplistically, if the range of stressors is greater than the range of buffers, they will have more negative health outcomes. And as Carol had mentioned previously, that's true for substance use, but it's also true for different chronic diseases. When we think specifically about Indigenous people's health, we do think about things like historic and ongoing trauma, the past and the present forms of colonization, the impact of racism, racial microaggressions, institutional racism, interpersonal racism. Think about the impact of violence, of poverty, of inadequate housing. All of those things cause stress. And we think about the buffers and really important buffers, which Carol also described so well, like traditional health and healing practices, connection to community, family, culture, tradition, spirituality. And part of what we need to understand, and referring back to that first slide in TRC Call to Action 18, was that the increase in stressors for Indigenous peoples through things like residential schools and the impact of the Indian Act was deliberate, like it was part of the colonial project. And at the same time, the reduction of access to those buffers, like access to language and culture and ceremony, was also deliberately disrupted, also through things like the Indian Act, the forcible removal of kids, disconnection to family. So it's no surprise that in an ongoing way, our people experience more negative health outcomes, including higher impact of harms from substance use. And I think I approach this mainly from a public health perspective, which means I'm looking more at prevention of substance use, delaying the onset of substance use, and reducing harm related to substance use than the treatments that Carol talked more about later on in her presentation. And so really what we're looking at is what are the structural things we can do to reduce exposure to those stressors, and how can we increase access, availability, and connection to those buffers? And then thirdly, how do we keep people as safe as possible while they're on that journey? So just a couple of slides. These ones are actually more related to opioid use, which is easier to track for a variety of reasons in the data systems that we have available. And just to give a really quick snapshot of the patterns of drug use in Winnipeg as an example of urban Indigenous population health. And these kind of statistics tend to hold the same across substances. So they wouldn't be different if they were graphs showing impacts from alcohol use or tobacco use or crystal meth, right? The specific titles would be different, but the patterns would be the same. So what it's showing is that mainly younger adults and youth who are impacted by this, but that we are seeing not tiny numbers in the age 10 to 14 range as well. On the right-hand side is the suspected opioid overdoses that went to the emergency room, and you can see, again, a significant gender difference with significantly more females experiencing overdoses. And again, really concerning the 10 to 14-year-old age bracket and the 15 to 19-year-old age bracket. And one of the things that I often mention to people is that is the age bracket that Tina Fontaine was in. So these are really highly targeted, marginalized young women who are experiencing these harms. And then what this slide is showing is just that most of the harms are concentrated in downtown Point Douglas, which is our more inner city areas of Winnipeg, which is also where there are concentrated populations of Indigenous peoples and higher rates of poverty and inadequate access to safe and affordable housing. I'm just going to skip the slide on the war on drugs. And just to describe briefly what I mean when I say an Indigenous public health approach. And really, it is a lot of what Carol has already demonstrated. So it's centering the experience of Indigenous people, working in relationships that respect Indigenous rights, and including centering Indigenous knowledge and frameworks in the work. It explicitly addresses multi-level racism at the structural level to reduce or remove colonial harm. It prioritizes the physical, social, and mental well-being of people who use drugs while maintaining and the continued respect of their inherent dignity and worth as human beings. Focuses on problematic or harmful use, which can be from the drug itself or can be from how society responds to people who use drugs. So, and by that, for example, a lot of the harm comes from involvement with the criminal justice system. It is evidence-informed, ethical, and pragmatic. And by evidence in that context, we're not just talking about quote-unquote Western scientific evidence, but again, Indigenous ways of knowing about what works and what is important. And then really focuses on avoiding further trauma or harm. So again, Carol had mentioned a lot of the pharmacology of crystal meth, so I'm not going to go through this too much. Just to let you know that in Winnipeg anyways, the vast majority of crystal meth use right now is actually by injection, and it is probably the best high for the lowest cost. Not probably, it actually is, and that has a lot to do with why it is a more common substance right now than opioids in Winnipeg. And that being said, just a reminder that alcohol continues to be the substance that actually causes the most harm. I'm going to skip over the brain effects again and some of this stuff because Carol has covered it. The one thing that I just wanted to reinforce over the long term and with the post-acute withdrawal is because of some of those changes in the neural synapses and particularly the down regulation of dopamine receptors, there can be a very long-term depression after one stops using crystal meth use that can be very difficult to treat. And that is one of the reasons why treatment, quote-unquote, in a recovery-based model for crystal meth has been or continues to be quite a bit different and difficult to manage compared to some other substances. So I wanted to talk a little bit about Aboriginal Youth Opportunities, who are partners that I've worked with for about the last 5 years. And one thing that I often will say is, you know, we had built a relationship over time. I had been able to leverage some resources to have them do some consultations, really just dialogues with people, meeting them where they're at to talk about health priorities for Indigenous youth in the North. And they had recognized the impact of crystal meth on their peers probably 18 months before it really hit media or government's attention. So how important it is to be close to the people that we are working with. And just to really highlight their first two priorities when it came to health in the North End, the first was to decriminalize all drugs, and the second was to promote harm reduction. So you may have seen this before. This is a Native Youth Sexual Health Network's model for harm reduction. The typical Western model is called the Four Pillars approach. It includes things like enforcement, but this one talks about centering community well-being and the restoration of different Indigenous knowledge systems, lifeways, ceremonies, culture, and governance structures as reducing the harm we experience in our lives. And it's not just talking about the harm from the substance use, which is like a distal harm, but about the harm from colonization, which is the root cause of the harm that then gets translated into expressions like harmful substance use. So they talk about the fire of cultural safety, so acknowledging the power differences that exist between service provider and client, allowing and creating spaces where Indigenous peoples can feel safe and be our whole selves when receiving care. The next one is reclamation, so reclaiming cultural practices that have been disrupted by colonial processes. Self-determination, so creating space for individuals, community, and nations to decide specifically what works best for us. And then sovereignty, so principles like non-interference that teach us to support and meet people where they're at. And so, for example, not forcing treatment, but like I mentioned, finding ways to support people's safety as much as possible while they use. And so this is a poster that we developed actually a couple of years ago, very early on in our 13 Moons project. This is a youth-led, culture-based program. Aboriginal Youth Opportunities is the lead, but it's supported by an executive circle that includes Ganiganichip, Manitoba Harm Reduction Network, and the Winnipeg Regional Health Authorities. Jenna has told the story multiple times about a friend of hers who was pregnant and was using substances and died by suicide because of her fear of what would happen to her baby once it was born, and really not seeing the hope that Carol had mentioned earlier for where she could get the support that she needed to live her own life and raise her baby in a healthy way. So the way that those four fires are kind of carried out in the 13 Moons program, I'll talk about the self-determination first. So The executive circle is co-chaired by someone from Aboriginal Youth Opportunities and has a couple of members from there, and that's the governance and executive model. Our three peer workers who do the outreach, harm reduction outreach, are all Indigenous youth who have been impacted by substances. And we also have a peer advisory circle of Indigenous youth who are using drugs, who meet regularly, provide guidance to the program to ensure that it is actually responsive to their needs. In terms of cultural safety, again, it is creating that space for Indigenous peer workers and Indigenous leadership. One of the things that we have talked about and that they will do is they will actually go with the people they're supporting who are using drugs when they're navigating other systems to try to create more safe space for them so that the people who are using drugs can just receive the services that they need without having to do that advocacy work too. They have been doing some training, and then they also have their own spaces that they create, such as Saturday night gatherings that I'll talk a little about in the reclamation next. So one of the things they're working on is 13 Moons teaching. So understanding and receiving knowledge from knowledge keepers about what each of the moons means, and then having discussions about what they can learn from those moon teachings, apply to their lives, and even to these concepts of harm reduction. And then for sovereignty, really is around meeting people where they're at. So our outreach workers do have information about how to access treatment if that is where someone is at. But most of what they do includes things like going out on the street with their backpacks, distributing harm reduction supplies, including safe injection kits, condoms, but they also will carry medicines, for example, or drums, and offer songs, smudging, things like that as well. So that is a little bit about how we're using this culture-based and youth leadership model to try to shift kind of the standard Western approach to respond to how we understand why the harms from drug use are being higher amongst the youth that we work with and support them in the ways that they want to be supported. So I am going to end there and turn it back over to the moderators for the question and answer session.